I want to welcome everyone here to the LBJ Library for what I think is a great event that means a lot to me that we're doing. And I want to also welcome each of you to the Future Forum. Future Forum is the younger group here, public policy discussion group, and we have a little bit of fun. I'm the chairman of the board of directors right now, and for the Future Forum members who are here, welcome back. And for those of you who are new, we'd encourage you to think about joining us as members. We try to get together at least quarterly, and we usually have to get together about 8 times a year for informative programs on current public policy and other items, coming together really in the spirit of LBJ, whose favorite biblical quote was, come, let us reason together. And that's really what we try to do here, which kind of led to the genesis of this panel and this topic. There's a lot of other groups that did have done discussions and have done panels on pros and cons, or the gay marriage debate, if you will. I started taking a look at it, and actually it really coincided and dovetailed nicely with an article that I got tipped off that Pam was writing. And the more I started talking to Pam, the more we started looking at it, the debate shifted from being a debate into really exploring the context of the same-sex marriage issues, what's going on historically, where we've been, where we are now with the court decisions, and where we're going, and how this is going to shape societal issues both within America, but also within the gay community as a whole. And that's part of the reason for the title, an idea whose time has come, invoking Victor Hugo and his quote, which was then later used in 1964 by MLK in his Nobel Peace Prize speech, and also by Everett Dirksen, Republican senator from Illinois minority leader, when making a motion for cloture on the Civil Rights Bill. So it all comes full circle. I'm thrilled to have the panel that we have here, and I'm so thrilled, in fact, that I actually invoked executive privilege as chairman of the board of directors to be able to moderate it. So I'm going to introduce them and then get the heck out of the way. First, I'm going to introduce Pam Colloff. Pam is executive editor of Texas Monthly and has written for the magazine since 1997. Her work has also appeared in The New Yorker and has been anthologized in the Best American Magazine Writing, Best American Crime Reporting, Best American Non-Required Reading, and Next Wave, America's Next New Generation of Great Literary Journalists.
Wow.
Pam is a 4-time National Magazine Award finalist. She was nominated in 2001 for her article on school prayer, and then again in 2011 for a 2-part series, Innocence Lost and Innocence Found, about wrongly convicted death row inmate Anthony Graves, which was, an aside, one of my favorite events that the Future Forum has ever done. It was a panel discussion with Pam and Anthony Graves that was just phenomenal. In 2013, she was nominated twice for more for Hannah and Andrew, and then as a man, a 2-part series about Michael Morton, the man who spent 25 years wrongfully imprisoned for the murder of his wife, Christine. The latter earned a National Magazine Award for feature writing. Pam, I'm just thrilled to have you here, so thank you. Next, I'd like to introduce Boyce Cabaniss, who Boyce is an attorney at Gray Starr here in Moody here in Austin, specializing in legal writing, and also particularly writing briefs at both the appellate and trial court level. He's held briefing for clients in the U.S. Supreme Court and pretty much every district around the country. He has extensive experience representing plaintiffs and defendants in everything from constitutional law matters to federal and state regulatory matters and everything in between. Boyce wrote a very interesting amicus brief. I helped write it on behalf of a group of history professors that was quoted by the Ninth Circuit, in their decision just recently, really looking at a lot of the historical, where we've been to get to this moment, and also where does it fit into the context of the greater both marriage debate, but also civil rights debate. And then, I want to introduce Vic Holmes and Mark Phariss. Vic entered the Air Force right after high school in 1988 and retired from active service in December 2010 as a major after almost 23 years of service. Thank you for doing that for our country. While in the military, he obtained both his bachelor's and master's degree from the University of Nebraska, became a physician assistant, received numerous awards, including the 2004 Outstanding Provider of the Year, the Air Force Achievement Medal 3 times, and the Air Force Commendation Medal. He's currently a physician assistant studies instructor at the University of North Texas in Fort Worth, position he's held since December 2010. In addition, he provides home-based medical care and services to physically and mentally challenged in Fort Worth and Louisville. Mark Phariss, a fellow attorney, received his undergraduate degree from Westminster College and his law degree from Vanderbilt Law School, where he was classmates with a guy who currently is the highest-ranking public official in the state of Texas.
Name escapes me. Yeah.
Mark has practiced general corporate law for over 29 years. Was a partner at a major Dallas law firm, and is currently the assistant general counsel of Expert Global Solutions, Inc., a $1.2 billion revenue business process outsourcing company based in Plano, Texas. He currently serves on the board of directors of Team SA Endowment, the foundation supporting the nonprofit San Antonio Spurs Sports, and Family Place, a Dallas-based safe haven for families of victims of family violence, which is a great organization. My dad actually once served on that board in Dallas. Great place. The reason we're here, the reason they're here, is on October 2013, Mark and Vic applied for a marriage license in San Antonio, and when denied, filed suit along with another couple challenging the constitutionality of Texas' ban on same-sex marriage. The district court ruled Texas' ban unconstitutional in February 2014. Texas appealed the decision to the Fifth Circuit, which heard oral arguments in January of this year. A decision is currently pending. We're all waiting. At the same time, and they'll get into this, there's also Supreme Court is taking another case. But I want to start things off because really kind of the inspiration for this, and in partnership with Texas Monthly, for those of y'all who haven't read it, Pam's cover story is fantastic. It's a fantastic look at both the people involved, but also with the issue in general. So, you know, Pam, I want to start off with you and ask you, you know, obviously this has been going on for a while, and the appeals were heard in January. Why now? Why do you think this is relevant now?
It seemed to be the perfect moment to be writing about this issue because, you know, when I started working on the story, the safe bet was that the Supreme Court was going to be taking this up between now and June, and that will indeed be happening. And we knew that the Fifth Circuit had oral arguments scheduled for January. So it seemed like a really great opportunity to write about this issue because I was literally going to be able to see the state stand up in front of a federal court and argue its position, and the opposite side as well. And so getting to know the plaintiffs in the case, the story is primarily focuses on the two female plaintiffs in the case who were hoping to join us but are on the verge of having a baby, so they could not be here. Sort of exploring their life and their history together and then juxtaposing that with the way that the Attorney General's office characterized them as being a threat to marriage seemed like a rich source of material, is the way I'll put it. So
that's great. And then, Vic and Mark, one of the things that has struck me about your story in particular is, you know, rewind 2.5 years. You guys are
I think I want to play it through again.
Yeah, that's the thing is, I mean, you guys had a quiet life and you're involved in your careers and in the community. What made you decide to kind of depart from that quiet life and say, we're going to do this? And also, you know, what were the what were the things y'all thought about then, and what's the reality been?
Well, it was clearly a temporary lapse of sanity.
Yeah.
You know, the main reason to pursue the lawsuit was because I love him. Mm-hmm. I met him over 17 years ago. I was immediately taken by him when I met him. I met him at the birthday party of mutual friends, and I had to follow him around at the party. We would talk in one group, and he'd meander off, and I'd have to go and see him again, and then he'd meander off again. So eventually, and then he left. And so I got his phone number and called him a couple days later, you know, waiting the proper amount of time. And
yeah, I didn't get that book. Where is this written?
So anyway, I eventually asked him out. It turned out he was dating someone else, so I had to wait for that to end. And then the minute that did, I pounced. And we've been together ever since. We went on a date, which actually coincides, since we're in a historic place, it coincides with the resignation. It was the anniversary of the resignation of Richard Nixon from the presidency. And that's why, as a historian buff, I can always remember when we, when our anniversary is. But, you know, we brought the lawsuit. I got involved in the lawsuit because I love Vic more than anything else. He's the person that I fell in love with when I first met him. He's the person that I've loved over the last 17 and a half years. He's the person I want to spend the rest of my life with, and he's the person I want to marry.
And for my part of it, that for the lawsuit, I could take it or leave it. When we started this, that was pretty much my attitude then. I can't take or leave him. I will take him, and that's that. And anything that I can do to maintain that, certainly. But when we first started this, there was a lot of angst, and the angst wasn't necessarily from my side of the. So to explain a bit, real fast, I was in the military. Most of you know that you heard the intro. When I was in the military, that was a different world. It was a different environment. It wasn't what it is now. And when I left the military, I left that behind. And I promised myself, and I did, and I have, that when I left the military, that second life would go away, and I would just have one life, and that one life would involve him, and that's all I needed. And when this all started, after the Windsor decision, Mark had talked to Frank Stenger, who was a friend of his with Akin Gump, and they've been friends for 20 years, God, more than that, maybe. How old is Frank, anyway? Crap, we're gonna record it. Anyway, so they've been friends for a long time. They talked about the Windsor decision and how someone in Texas should do something, and gosh, if only somebody could do something, but that would require a pretty substantial commitment from a law firm, from the plaintiffs, et cetera. And we weren't in it at that point. It was just a discussion that somebody should do something. And Frank actually took that back to his group, Akin Gump, Barry Chasnoff took it to the board. The board said, hey, let's do this. And then they started looking for plaintiffs. And Frank called back and said, yeah, all we have to do is find plaintiffs. Any idea where we could find plaintiffs that maybe one of them might be a veteran, one of them might be a lawyer? So, and we thought about it, and I was okay with it, and I could take it or leave it, frankly, because it wasn't a decision that I was making. It was a decision that if he was going to do this with me, we would do it, and if he didn't want to do it, then we weren't going to do it, and that was it. It wasn't, there was nothing else to it, and so we talked about it, and many times we said, yes, someone should do this thing. And so we're on board with it. And then the reality of what that would involve hits. You're not yourself anymore. There's all the people. There's everyone knows your life. And the hope of having that quiet in the closet, that's gone. And so with those realizations, maybe not. My office, awesome. Great folks. But my office isn't as conservative as Mark's. And that is a very important point. So that was a big driver.
Yeah, I mean, we had all kinds of fears from security, fears. And all you have to do is see in the news from last June, when a lone gunman attacked the synagogue in Kansas City to reinforce in your mind that it only takes one nut. And then you see that a bill is, or an attempt to have a ballot initiative in California by a lawyer that filed the fee and that wants literally the citizens to vote whether or not gays and lesbians should be put to death. When you know that there are people out there with those positions, that immediately is internalized in me, that makes me worry that we're a little too out there. We've received from, and thankfully they were all good, but we've received about 7 or 8 letters from different people at state pens across the state.
To our house, to me,
and asking for legal advice in a couple of them. I'm ill-equipped for that.
Dating advice.
A corporate lawyer doesn't know how to help anyone out of a pen.
Must get the other way around.
Yeah, a couple of them wanted me to introduce them to some of my friends, which I'm not inclined to do. And then a couple, I have no idea what in the world the letters were saying. But in any event, they were not threatening. So. In general, we've had a lot of fears, both with job and with security and with a whole slew, and thankfully none of that's come to pass.
And one thing I'll say is that people, when you're a real person, you are all here, and I can see you here. And so when you express your opinions, I can see you doing that. But when you're not a real person, when you're a name on a blog, for example, or an email or an anonymous tip, that was where the majority of negativity that we saw came from. And the thing that I found the most reassuring about that entire process wasn't that we had negative people. It was that the number of negative people was counterbalanced by the number of positive people. And in almost every case, every negative opinion was beaten down by the number of people saying, you know, dude, you're off base. Whatever you're seeing is, you need to go to a closet and work it out.
Yeah, we learned not to read the comments to articles.
Ever.
Yeah. Yeah. Usually a good idea.
Yeah.
Usually a good idea. And Boyce, this is all kind of against a backdrop of, Texas, of course, in 2005 had a ballot initiative to add a constitutional amendment banning same-sex marriage. A lot has happened over the last decade. It still is in a conservative state. Like Texas, still a hot issue, particularly with the legislature we have right now. And so it's commonplace to see a lot of different political groups file amicus briefs. Mm-hmm. But the thing that for me was different about the amicus brief that you wrote was it was on behalf of a group of history professors. Talk about why the group of history professors were involved. And really what the direction of the amicus brief was.
Okay. Well, first of all, you're giving me a little bit too much credit for it because it was written mostly by Nancy Cott, who's a wonderful history professor at Harvard. And her specialty is social history, in particular history of marriage. And there were 19 other professors from around the country, including one from the University of Texas that specialized in the history of marriage. And they had filed this brief in some of the other federal cases that were challenging same-sex marriage state bans. And Danny Ramone, who is another one of our law partners sitting in the audience back there, they asked you, didn't they, to help with the brief at the Texas case at the Fifth Circuit. And I kind of took over the project. I think Danny was busier than I was. But what I did, and any value I added to it, was to tailor it to the arguments that the state of Texas was making. And the first thing I did was go back and look at the old miscegenation cases that Texas, like at one point, virtually every state in the union, had statutes banning interracial marriage. And those statutes were periodically challenged. And in Texas, the main case was a 19th century case, which upheld the anti-miscegenation laws. But the arguments that the state made in that case were virtually identical to the ones they're making now. I mean, almost word for word. And it was just astounding. So I added a section of the brief.
And Boyce, what are those arguments?
Well, there's a bunch of them. The first ones are, the brief starts out with, in 2005, 76% of the voters of the state of Texas defined marriage as between a man and a woman. Well, of course, that they leave out that that was based on a 17% voter turnout. So that's 76% of 17%. The 19th century case on the anti-miscegenation laws started out with almost the same thing. It said, it is pointless to count the innumerable laws that incorporate the concept that has long been upheld by the citizens of Texas that marriage between whites and blacks should not occur. And this, going down the list, one of the more galling arguments was the ban on same-sex marriage is not unconstitutional because it affects everyone equally. Everyone has the right to marry somebody of the opposite sex. Therefore, it's not discriminatory. The same point was made in the 19th century case. I mean, it's just eerie how you can go down the list and they're all exactly the same arguments. It's interesting that Mark said that he did this for love because to encapsulate the main argument that Texas is making now, love is not enough. Mm-hmm. Marriage is a subsidy, an economic subsidy and a social subsidy that the state has a discretion to give to couples that it thinks are adding something to the value of society. And heterosexual couples reproduce. Marriage fosters a stable home to raise a child. So the state can prefer them over same-sex couples that, by definition, don't reproduce. But my understanding was that one of the plaintiffs was sitting not too far from the attorney when he was making the argument to the Fifth Circuit, and she's obviously with child.
Yeah.
So the judges can kind of...
The responsible procreation argument was my favorite part of writing about this story because it just fails on its face. There are several things that just on its face make no sense. So we don't prohibit infertile couples from marrying. We don't prohibit the elderly from marrying. We would never dare to say that their unions are not beneficial to the state. And yet, somehow, this was different in this case. And it was also really striking to me, again, when the Solicitor General went before the Fifth Circuit in January, what Boyce was referring to, that he's, on the one hand, making the case that the children of Texas need the stability of a two-parent home. But somehow that only applies to the children of straight people and not of gay people. There are 19,000 children in Texas being raised by gays and lesbians. And gays and lesbians have children, either via adoption or through surrogates or other means. And so to literally sit there and deny fact with one of the plaintiffs sitting there 15 feet away was really remarkable.
Clearly showing, by the way.
And an interesting thing about Nicole and Cleo is that they actually, before they had their first child, they actually went to Massachusetts to get married so that they would have their first child in a marriage.
Yep.
And the other interesting thing about Texas's position before the Fifth Circuit was and in their briefs, they have the ability to argue that it's about procreation and love, mm-hmm. that it's a combined principle. They don't argue that, though. It's purely procreation and has nothing to do with love. And it is the oddest argument I think I've ever heard. And certainly the least persuasive. They would have gotten a lot further, it seems to me, if they would have argued that it was procreation and love, and you had to have both of those. Mm-hmm. But again, they didn't do that. And as our lawyer, Neil Lane, with Akin Gump said when he was at the lectern arguing before the Fifth Circuit, he pointed out that if there was anyone redefining marriage, mm-hmm. it was the state, not us. It was a redefinition that few people, if anyone, would recognize these days.
And I wish you could have been there. I mean, just the visual. It was an experience for me, having not been in that kind of a situation before, but the justices were intent on getting the information. They asked questions of both sides. They really were interested in the case. And that I personally found gratifying. But each of them has their own mannerisms. And the majority of them are fairly laid back, fairly quiet. They make their decisions. They ask the questions and so forth. But they do so kind of like, you know, just like we're having a conversation. Mm-hmm. And when the Solicitor General stood up and said that marriage is not about love, all three of them leaned in. And all three of them had the look on their face of, they could not have been more surprised if he'd pulled a tap dancing squid out of his briefcase. It was just astonishing the way that they reacted to his argument as well.
And this is the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals, which is widely regarded as one of the most, if not the most conservative mm-hmm. court of appeals, federal court of appeals in the country. And actually, you know, I wasn't there, but by most accounts, both in your article, mm-hmm. Pam, but by people that were there, they were pretty, they grilled the Solicitor General pretty darn well, you know, especially over this whole notion of responsible procreation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Exactly. It was fun to watch.
But point out that maybe a little bit kind of counterintuitive to what may be in the best interest of children in the state.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Pam, wasn't it, maybe you remember better than I do, wasn't it Higginbotham who made the comment that you don't have to have incentives to have sex?
Yes.
Well, that was awesome. Well, you don't have to pay people.
It's to that point, you know, that the notion that heterosexuals should benefit from the fact that they can have casual sex and accidental children, but that gays and lesbians who have to go to great lengths to create a child within a relationship should be penalized. It just every aspect of it was rather ironic.
Higginbotham's questions were, I don't know if they were surprising, but he's 76, he's from Alabama, he was appointed by Reagan, and he's mm-hmm. he has a reputation for being a reasoned conservative, but his questions indicated that he was very sympathetic to the plaintiffs, mm-hmm. very sympathetic. And then the other two members of the panel was Judge Graves, who was an Obama appointee, and then Jerry Smith, who I believe is also a Reagan appointee mm-hmm. or a Bush 1 appointee. And he is best known as one of the most social, conservative judges in the panel, especially on social issues. Mm-hmm. I think he only asked a few questions, and they were directed at why the federal government has the authority to redefine what has traditionally been a state issue.
Baker v. Nelson.
I'll just add one other thing. Higginbotham himself, an Alabama native, drew a parallel between this and the civil rights movement. Yeah. It was a really powerful moment because there were three states arguing their same-sex marriage cases that day. So Louisiana, Mississippi, and Texas. And so I believe it was during Mississippi's case, their attorney general was speaking, and he said something in response to, you know, something about same-sex marriage being legalized at some point in Mississippi in the future. And he said something to the effect of, well, I don't know when Mississippi will be ready. I'm not getting that quite right, but something to that effect. Mm-hmm. And Higginbotham said, in this very regal way, we've heard those words, when will Mississippi be ready, in these halls before. Mm-hmm. And everybody knew what that meant. Mm-hmm. And it was really powerful. Mm-hmm.
It was very powerful. Mm-hmm.
With, I think, only maybe two exceptions, every federal court that's looked at this issue has struck down state court bans. And the Supreme Court was willing to let that process continue because they refused to take one of these early on, which surprised everyone. But they would rather not have to exercise their authority on this unless they're forced to. When they were forced to, when the Sixth Circuit, in a 2-1 decision, was the first appellate court that reached a contrary conclusion. And at that point, the Supreme Court had to act because clearly you can't have a constitutional right to same-sex marriage in some states but not others. That wouldn't do. So that's why they took the case. But they took it with some reticence, I think.
And the only thing I'll add to that is what's interesting is the Sixth Circuit was, I think, put their decision on hold. They took the mm-hmm. longest to issue mm-hmm. a decision. They put their decision on hold while there were certs on appeal mm-hmm. by before the Supreme Court for various states.
Right.
And the Supreme Court in October denied those certs mm-hmm. and allowed the stays to be lifted so that in all those various states, including my home state of Oklahoma, same-sex marriages are now allowed to occur, which baffles me beyond belief that Oklahoma's ahead of anything. But
Oklahoma.
So, you know, as an aside, I was told by my lawyers never, ever to tell anyone that I have season tickets to Oklahoma football. The interesting thing about the Sixth Circuit's decision is it came after the Supreme mm-hmm. Court denied cert from all those states. And what's baffling is how could the Sixth Circuit not get a hint? You know, how did they miss that signal? Mm-hmm. I think they just could not, in their own minds, get there, regardless of, I think they have to know how the Supreme Court's going to rule,
right.
But I think they just refused to write that opinion themselves.
The odd thing is, apparently they wanted to go on record as mm-hmm. as being opposed to this, and I think the vast majority of judges do not, because they don't want to be on the wrong side of history. Mm-hmm. One of the cases we cited in the Samikas brief is Perez v. Smith. It's a 1948 California Supreme Court decision, and it's the first state Supreme Court decision striking down the anti-miscegenation laws. And one of the justices, who I think is the longest serving member of the California Supreme Court, very august career, all sorts of firsts, very, very well respected, he dissented. And if you Google him now, the first thing that comes up is that dissent. Mm-hmm. His entire 40-year career, he's known for that dissent. And judges are aware of that sort of thing. They're aware of how history will judge them. Mm-hmm. They don't want to be on the wrong side of mm-hmm. this issue. And I think that's guiding some of them.
Boyce, let me ask a question of the audience real quickly, because you've mentioned amicus briefs a couple times. Does everyone know what amicus brief is? Because if not, I mean...
Yeah, I'm sorry, I'm used to talking to other lawyers, and I forget that sometimes people don't understand what I'm talking about. It's a friend of the court brief, that somebody with an interest in the outcome of a case can file a brief to help the court reach the right decision.
Yeah. Support.
One of my favorite amicus briefs filed along with the plaintiffs was filed by a number of Fortune 500 companies who want to see these laws change in Texas. They want to do business in Texas. That was fascinating to me to read that.
Mm-hmm. That was pretty awesome, actually.
Good business.
Mm-hmm. I think isn't 90%, I think, Fortune 500 mm-hmm. countries, companies have anti-discrimination policies. Mm-hmm. So yeah. Business has spoken, I think, on the issue.
And looking at the Fifth Circuit case, and then also looking at the Sixth Circuit giving the Supreme Court with this opportunity to, or whether it's an opportunity is a euphemism, or whether they're being forced to actually rule on the issue. One of the things I wanted to ask the panel, obviously the same-sex marriage cases are one issue that faces the homosexual community right now. Talk a little bit about, where does that issue fit in with the larger issue? Because one of the things that really struck me, both being a lawyer, but also just being a human being, is in the article, Pam, you mentioned that, if the Fifth Circuit rules in favor of the plaintiffs, and if the Supreme Court obviously strikes down bans on same-sex marriage, you could have a situation where you'd legally be able to get married. Mm-hmm. But you could still, from a civil rights perspective, get fired from your job.
Mm-hmm. Yep. The movement, as two people somewhat involved in the movement, I can say it's not over when mm-hmm. the Supreme Court rules mm-hmm. in June. I mean, there's really, in my opinion, no chance, absent a death on the Supreme Court, there's no chance the Supreme Court's going to uphold a ban on same-sex marriage. But what will happen is someone in Texas literally could go get married on a Saturday or Sunday, return to work on Monday, announce that they're married, unless they're in one of the cities that provide protection, could then be fired mm-hmm. For having gotten married, or be fired because the employer now finds out that they're gay.
And that's under state law.
That's under state law.
Under 20, and that was the very thing we were worried about when we started this, because it's one thing to file the suit, and even if the suit plays itself out, even when the suit is long gone, we still have to work. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And, I like what I do. He likes what he does. I think we do a good job at it, and the folks seem to appreciate it. But we can't do it if every employer we go to says, oh, gay. Now,
29 states have no protection.
Exactly.
For gay people, and Title VII is the federal law that prevents discrimination in employment, but it does so based on specific categories, including race, gender, national origin, ethnicity, religion, not including sexual orientation, and the law, the Title VII law on LGBT. People has become very strange in that courts have not found, uniformly not found, protections for people based just on their sexual orientations. But since gender is one of the categories, if you fail to conform to gender stereotypes, then you are protected. So courts have ruled that men who dress like women or wear makeup or wear women's jewelry are protected, and women who dress like men or come to work in biker gear are protected, but people in the middle are not protected. Gay people in the middle are not protected, and that's a very kind of strange situation for the law to be in. And there's a couple of district courts have ruled, and I don't think any circuit courts have ruled on this yet, but in states where, there is no protection, but someone gets married in another state and comes back, say somebody gets married in Massachusetts, comes back to Texas, and they're fired, and then they sue, and at least a couple of courts have held that being married to somebody of your same sex is failure to conform with gender stereotypes and therefore is protected under Title mm-hmm. VII. Mm-hmm. But the next general step, I think, and you may have been about to say this, is to get INDA passed, mm-hmm. which is the
Employment
Non-Discrimination Act, which has been trying to be passed through Congress for a while now. There's not much chance in the current Congress, and it's going to go through. It'll have to wait to some future date. And the other possibility is for the there needs to be legislation. I was going to say a Supreme Court decision that finds that gay people are a member of a suspect class, which increases the protection of the mm-hmm. equal rights under the Equal Protection Clause. But that probably wouldn't be good enough to protect people from private employer discrimination. So ENDA really needs to be passed at some point.
And that's a very key point, because that actually ties in very nicely to the case currently before the Supreme Court, and it ties into how the vote comes out. There are two issues before the Supreme Court. There's a recognition issue, and then there's a rights issue. The recognition issue is the recognition of an out-of-state marriage in another state. And the rights issue is whether or not Vic and I, unmarried, have the right to be married in the state of Texas. So those are really the two issues before the Supreme Court. There's a lot of speculation going on about how the vote will come out on the Supreme Court. And it is viewed that the recognition issue is more likely to get more votes than the rights issue, that it's potentially possible you could get a 7-2 vote on the recognition issue and not on the rights issue, that at best you'll get a 6-3 vote, maybe most likely is a 5-4. And how the vote turns out is very important, because Roberts, as the Chief Justice, gets to determine who writes the opinion as long as he's in the majority. If he's not in the majority, the senior person in the majority gets to determine. And so there is a lot of speculation. I personally believe that Roberts is going to join the majority so that he gets to write the opinion, so that he gets to write it in as narrow a way as possible, so that you do not have a decision coming out of the Supreme Court that has heightened scrutiny of other actions going forward. That's my fear. In some ways, I'd prefer that we stick with a 5-4 decision, because a Kennedy decision will probably be a little broader and a little more protective going forward. So that's kind of what's going on in the background.
And for those of you that don't get that part, suspect class, basically that means that if the state wants to discriminate against you, they can either just discriminate against you just flat out and say, no, we have an interest in this particular outcome.
The rational basis.
We don't have to prove why we have an interest. We just have to say that we have an interest. And that's pretty much it. It's basically because I said so. And the next level up, they have to actually prove the heightened scrutiny levels. That's where they have to actually say, okay, we don't actually have a rational reason for it, but we have this very specific thing that we're trying to get across. That's why we're cutting all of you people out of something, because there really is a state interest, and now I'm going to prove that the state has this special interest where they didn't have to prove it before.
Crystal ball time. I think we pretty much all agree that how do you see the Fifth Circuit ruling coming out, and how do you see the Supreme Court ruling, and with acknowledgement the Supreme Court ruling could effectively moot out the Texas court ruling?
I think everyone who is there for oral arguments before the Fifth Circuit thinks it'll be a 2-1 vote overturning the state bans. Mm-hmm. And for more details, you can read my article to explain that. But what's frustrating is we don't know if the Fifth Circuit is going to rule before the Supreme Court takes this up or not. And I was just saying before we started, I get these email announcements every time they hand down a decision, and it's always this heart-stopping moment in my day, and then, it's not there. So I don't know if they'll wait for the Supreme Court or not. I think that'll be really interesting to see.
The easy way out would just be for them to punt and wait. Mm-hmm. But based on the passion with which Higginbotham asked his questions, I think they're going to rule.
Mm-hmm. Well, that and...
Yeah, well, I mean, it's all a guess. Everyone's reading tea leaves. I mean, I certainly think they're going to rule. There was a case on the Monday before our hearing on abortion, and that case has not yet been issued. The decision has not yet been issued in that either. The Fourth Circuit and the Tenth Circuit took 2.5 months to issue their decision. We are just as of last Friday, and I'm counting. We're at 2 months. 2 months. This Friday, will be, you know, we're getting closer. Obviously, next Friday will be at 2.5 months. So that's been the time frame for most of the decisions. Considering that the abortion case hasn't been issued yet, it would indicate that, and now it's a different panel, mm-hmm. but it would indicate that they're going slow, and that doesn't necessarily mean they're sitting on it. They could be. We have no idea, but it doesn't necessarily mean that.
But or, it would be powerful. Oral arguments are before the Supreme Court in about a month. It would be very powerful, obviously, mm-hmm. to have that decision come down before then mm-hmm. from right. such a conservative court.
Yeah, but regardless of where the decision comes from, it's also really kind of important to understand that a decision that comes down is going to change things. That is true. It's going to change the legal landscape, certainly. But it's not going to change people. People are still going to be people. And I think that one of the things that's really influenced this whole case, set of cases, issue the most is that people have gotten to know their neighbors. They've gotten to know their friends. They've gotten to know their cousins, their uncles, aunts, whomever. They've gotten to know these people who were previously demonized. They know that they're not these horrible people that whoever is in power has painted them as. And so they know that that's not the case anymore. When the law changes, that's the only thing that changes. It doesn't change the people. They have to change inside themselves. But what the law will do, it will allow us to be public about who we are without having to worry as much. Does it mean that we're going to walk down the streets of Dallas hand in hand? Who would feel safe with that? Things will still have to change.
We've clearly not been public up to this point, so. The only thing I'll also point out in terms of the timing from the Fifth Circuit is the former Attorney General, as well as us, have asked the Fifth Circuit to go ahead and rule so that both sides mm-hmm. have asked the Fifth Circuit not to sit on it mm-hmm. and to issue mm-hmm. a decision to influence the Supreme Court. Mm-hmm. So I think that helps weigh in favor as well that the Fifth Circuit will rule.
Mark, you touched on something I want to follow up on. And you mentioned, either Fifth Circuit or Sixth Circuit just heard a case on abortion, which raises an interesting question. Assuming that the Fifth Circuit and the Supreme Court rulings come out the way that I think all of us think it's going to, do you think in terms of politics and in terms of what I would call kind of legislative activism, do you think a constitutional right to same-sex marriage, do you think it will go the way of the anti-miscegenation rulings and where society just says, well, hey, we're ready for it, it makes sense? Or do you think we'll see what we saw in the aftermath of Roe v. Wade, where you see social conservatives chip away and critics mm-hmm. chip away and try to almost do an end around right. against the constitutional arguments?
I mean, that's a very good question. And I believe and obviously certainly hope that the historical precedent is how everyone reacted after Loving v. Virginia. And they'll accept interracial marriages. They'll accept same-sex marriages just like they accepted interracial marriages, and we'll move on. And I pretty much think if you look at the polling now, that's where we are. We've got, across the country, nationally it's 60% or more now support same-sex marriages. Even in Texas, and this is an outdated poll, but it was more than a year ago. It's a Texas Tech poll, and it was a plurality of Texans supported same-sex marriage. And I just think as we go forward and everyone sees couples and meets couples who are married the simple fact of the matter is not one married couple is going to get a divorce because Vic and I can get married. Not one engaged couple is going to call it
off. Off the market.
Right. I mean, it's going to have, it has no impact on anyone else. I mean, Vic and I are a couple now. That doesn't affect anyone else. And the fact that we are married and get all the rights and benefits and recognition that everyone else gets will have no impact on anyone else. So I just simply do not see it.
I think we have an example, though. I mean, it's not. We can guess, I suppose. But so when I retired from the military, 7 days before I retired, that's when they signed the repeal for Don't Ask, Don't Tell. And I remember that whole year, there was a lot of prep work. The military was getting people ready. This is going to happen. And there's a lot of education that went into it. This is the policy. This is how things are going to work out. And there was so much angst about when this thing happens. Now there's going to be all kinds of bizarrety in locker rooms and what's going to happen on the front lines. And nobody's going to know who to trust anymore. And it never happened. None of it. Not one bit of it. People who acted inappropriately were treated for exactly the same way that people who act inappropriately would be treated, or be treated rather. And none of the things that they said would come to pass did. It was a lot of worry. It was a lot of angst. But it was for nothing, because when the thing actually happened, everyone went on with their lives.
I agree that from a social perspective, I think it's going to be like Loving v. Virginia, which is the Supreme Court decision that struck down the remaining anti-miscegenation laws in the 13 states that still had them, sadly, including Texas. Texas kind of always brings up the rear, it looks like. The tipping point, you know, has been reached in society. Mm-hmm. It's you can't watch a show on television now without seeing a gay person. And the NFL threatened to pull the Super Bowl from Arizona if they passed the law allowing discrimination against gay people. But what Arizona, the law that Arizona was suggesting that the governor said she would veto, that so far is the reaction by social conservatives. It's to use the First Amendment's free exercise of religion clause as a weapon to push back the anti-discrimination laws. It's pitting the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment against the First Amendment. And the examples they use, we don't want any anti-discrimination laws to force a Catholic church to hire a transvestite. I mean, of course, the extreme examples, but the argument is it is important to protect religious beliefs, and many religious beliefs do not accept homosexuality, open homosexuality, gay marriage. Therefore, we're going to pass these state laws that protect those beliefs and allow people to decline, to allow a baker to decline to make a wedding cake for a same-sex marriage. And it's kind of the same argument that it's a step beyond actually the argument that carried the day in the Hobby Lobby decision, the Supreme Court decision from last year, I suppose, that said that Hobby Lobby, even though it's a corporation, could opt out of healthcare provisions that required providing insurance coverage for various birth control things. So that's going to be, I think, a battleground in the next few years. It's already happening.
And it's happening in our legislature right now.
Yeah. Yeah, it is.
Session has been pretty interesting on the subject.
Pam, I have a quick kind of final question for you before we open up for a few questions. Focusing once again on your story, when you sat down, and the thing I love about, I think you've described yourself as an unabashed lover of long-form journalism, which I think is terrific. And speaking of long-form journalism and being able to really get into a story, did this end up being the story that you originally set out to write?
No, which it never is. But I love legal stories, and I was fascinated with the legal arguments, and I thought that writing about the plaintiffs would be obviously part of the story, but that it would really be a legal drama. And I think what the story ended up being, though part of it is a legal drama, is a love story. And it's a love story between two women who don't have the same civil rights as I do and don't have the same ability to have a lot of the freedoms that I do. And that was really very upsetting to really think about, especially as I got to know Nicole and Cleo more, and I thought more and more about the gay and lesbian friends who I parent beside and who I'm friends with, whose lives I thought I understood, and I really didn't. And so hopefully the story addresses that.
I think it does.
Wonderful, yeah.
can I make two quick points? You said that you remembered your anniversary because it's on the date that that Nixon resigned. I remember mine with my partner, Tom, because we met on the 100th anniversary of the hurricane that destroyed Galveston.
And what's with these disasters?
You could read a lot
into it.
And the other quick point is, somebody before I came asked if we were going to have anybody to represent the con position on same-sex marriage, and I said, well, I don't think so. So I will mention a New Yorker cartoon from a couple of years ago to represent the con position. It showed a woman at a breakfast table and her husband, who's looking very grumpy and just kind of sitting like this, and she's reading the paper and saying, I oppose same-sex marriage because those people have just suffered enough.
That's awesome.
And with that, anyone in the audience have any questions that they'd like to ask the panelists? Or is everyone just really, really ready to get to the point?
Brian.
Yes, sir.
Hey. The thing that sort of really interested me about the court cases and the progress of same-sex marriage in the courts is that it's all happened in the courts. So it's been pretty much a legal process by which this has happened. And the lawyers have really driven the show in this. And because of that, the same-sex proponents have prevailed because it turns out that they have the stronger legal arguments. And what's been really striking to me is that the legal arguments on the anti-marriage side have just completely collapsed along the way. I mean, the thing about the Fifth Circuit argument that really, I was really kind of surprised when I read the dailies about the subsidy argument that the state of Texas was...
They were surprised.
It was just really, I mean, really, yeah, that's like the best we got. I mean, you know, like, it's sort of like a card game. It's like, you got nothing. That's sort of like what it came down to. But the thing is that, you know, like, that's the legal arguments. It turns mm-hmm. out that the legal arguments are really weak because the inspiration for the opposition to same-sex marriage is not coming from law, it's coming from social tradition and specifically from religion. Mm-hmm. And that, of course, within the court system, you can't make a legal argument right. based on your religious beliefs.
Right.
And,
mm-hmm.
you know, like, as much as I'm personally happy that the cases have been going this way, mm-hmm. I have to say that that's a good question about whether or not the result of the Supreme Court decision is going to be more like Loving or it's going to be more like Roe.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like it to be like more like Loving, but I'm not sure that that's going to happen because mm-hmm. there's some social and religious beliefs that are tied up with the opposition to mm-hmm. same-sex marriage that the court cases are not going to address.
Mm-hmm.
And so these are more sort of observations. I'm just sort of like kind of curious to hear from particularly the legal people on the panel mm-hmm. why you think if you agree with that assessment that the legal opposition fell apart so quickly because they couldn't bring up religion. And the second part of the question would be how you think this very legal, secular decision, if it comes down from the Supreme Court, will be accepted by people whose basis for their opposition to same-sex marriage comes from religion.
Your second point is an interesting one. Justice Ginsburg, who is one of the four, you know, considered liberal members of the court, in public comments, she has said that it would have been possibly better in retrospect, and I don't want to put words in her mouth, but the thought was, if the Supreme Court had not decided Roe v. Wade, the states looked like they were going in the direction of loosening restrictions on abortion themselves. Some had already done so. Others were kind of moving in that direction. And it wasn't, it's become a big evangelical issue, a Protestant issue, and then it kind of wasn't. And that's happened after the decision of Roe v. Wade, and it's become this huge political issue. And I think, and this is maybe just me, maybe other people agree, that one of the reasons the court didn't take this case when all of the courts of appeals were lining up and agreeing was to kind of avoid that, to step back and not make a ruling on this. But now they have to. And that is a good question. Is it going to cause a backlash? Because society is, I think we've reached the tipping point. Society is moving toward acceptance, but this might cause a little bit of a backlash. I don't know. It may not. That'll be a very interesting question. And the reason, to your other point, the reason that religious arguments can't really be made here is because of the two religion clauses, the free exercise and the establishment clause. And if you argue that we're doing this statute banning same-sex marriage, we're doing because the Bible tells us so, then that immediately runs afoul of the establishment clause.
Were you surprised that the anti-marriage side couldn't come up with better non-religious arguments?
Frankly, yes. it was.
It's hard to argue with the equal protection clause.
Yeah. You know. Yeah, but it was really like they're just like phoning it in. We know we've lost this, and here's these arguments we have to make, so see ya.
Yes, sir.
Can one of the legal people on the panel recap the nature of the arguments in Loving against the overturning of the miscegenation law? Are they religiously based?
No, they knew even then not to fall into the establishment clause trap. The best survey of those arguments is in the dissent in that California Supreme Court decision I was telling you about, Phariss v. Smith, 1948. And that judge is very accomplished, was a brilliant jurist, and explained all the arguments. And when we go back and read them now, He one of the arguments was based on biology, like the state is making now, that, you know, doesn't biology itself teach us that the races are separate and should remain separate, and they have always been separate, and nothing like this has ever happened before, and the mixing of the races has, you know, been illegal for forever and ever and ever, and tradition is a big part of the argument. And children, there was an argument that, you know, why would you do this to the children that would be products of these, you know, unnatural marriages, because they would be, you know, they would be different from everyone else and they would be discriminated against and you were giving them horrible lives, and why would you even consider doing that? And the worst thing of all, the most shocking to somebody from a perspective of 2015, they relied on eugenics studies from the early part of the last century, which are just horrifying. And the main reason the California statute was passed was not, California didn't have the history of slavery and didn't have at that time, the early part of the century when these laws were passed, didn't have a large black population. They had a large Asian population. And that's what California was trying to prevent, was marriages between Asians and Anglos.
I think we have time probably for one quick question, and then I want to invite all of our panelists to join everyone else for a reception where hopefully the discussion can continue. So one more hand.
So I can see this from both sides, perspective for everyone here. It's like eyes are on the Supreme Court, on the court of appeals, so on and so forth. And it's pretty much within the movement. It's odd, but the state has been left out. Like, nobody's even looking or asking of the state of anything relating to this, but eventually if we talk about protection for jobs, etc., we will have to depend on the state legislatures and legislative movement somewhere. All right, can we just like depend on it at all, or is the legislature just a lost cause at this point?
The current one I don't think we can depend on.
Depends on what you're depending on for.
There was a celebration, I guess, week before last at the Capitol with a pink cake. and celebrated the 10th anniversary of the ban on same-sex marriage in Texas. And there
celebrated
were
the day they voted away civil rights.
Yeah.
Who does that?
And there were, of course, speeches about how same-sex marriage would destroy the fabric of society and was more dangerous than terrorism and would end civilization as we know it.
And there's a famous quote about that no man, woman, or child is safe the 135 days that the Texas legislature's in session. And that was said a long time ago before this one. I think, you know, this is one of those issues where, I think a lot of issues where a legislature can do more good by just getting out of the way than anything else. Having said that, I want to thank each and every one of you for being part of this. I want to thank Mark and Vic especially for coming down from Dallas. Thank you.